is part two of four of The Niece by Margot Livesey from the text What If? Writing Exercises for Fiction Writers. When I was 15, she said, and her tone was such that he couldn't tell if she was talking to him or herself, my parents let me paint my room. We were a family. This probably sounds absurd. Who never painted anything? First, I wrote on the wall the things I wanted to be rid of. Hypocrisy, mother, father, brother. Then I slapped on the paint, deep purple. Did it work? Her head swiveled in his direction, and he had the sense of being seen at last. Not, she exhaled, entirely. But I did like the feeling of making my mark. Do you ever get the glums? No, he said. And then the words seemed to leap from his larynx. Sometimes. To his own stupefaction, he imagined telling her the whole deformed story, the one his mother wanted to wrap up in euphemisms, like oval in newspaper, like opal in newspaper, and chuck in the dustbin. Why, brother, he asked. I have one, her eyebrows dashed together. In America, maybe. She seized a wallpaper brush and fingered the gluey bristles. Years ago, when I was hitching near Oxford, and a polystyrene salesman picked me up. The back seat of his car was full of those nice white containers, all different sizes. It started to rain, bucketing down, the windscreen wipers going lickety-split, and he said, do you ever think of killing yourself? His voice was so casual, I was sure I'd misunderstood. Like you, just now, I said, sometimes. Zeke blinked again rapidly. Then he asked if I'd read Steppenwolf. I said yes, though to be honest, I wasn't sure. It's one of those books that was in the ether for a while. I looked over at this porky, red-faced, middle-aged bloke, and his eyes were brimming. I have, he said. Every day I think of it. There is always the razor and the knife. She set aside the brush and flicked a roll of lining paper. Are you taking off the paper just to put it on again? The Barrows, her aunt and uncle, had asked that too. He explained about the old houses of London, how the walls were held up by wood chip paper. When you remove it, the best way to get a smooth finish was to put on lining paper and paint over that. Cup of tea, he suggested, and, cursing himself, backed out of the room. Once, maybe twice a year, he had something that resembled a conversation. Something not about fish fingers or telly or who was effing who. And, idiotically, he bolted. Blind rejection was one thing, to be seen, then dismissed, was quite another. He might hate his mother's mealy-mouthed phrases, oh, Zeke's just under the weather, but the day, 6 years earlier, that she turned her shiny blue eyes upon him and said, you'll end up in the loony bin if you carry on like this, he had felt as if a pickaxe were aimed at the very center of his forehead. Afraid to return to the living room, he hovered beside the kettle, give me another surge, he thought. Winging his request to head office, he heard a sound in the hall, one thud followed another. Did I scare you? Seeing her stocking feet, he understood not only the noises he just heard, but those that came most nights through his bedroom ceiling. One shoe, two shoe, which side are you on? He said. Round heads or cavaliers, arsenals or Chelsea, flat earth or solar system. Mr. and Miss Barrow, he pushed a mug of tea towards her. Whose niece are you? Misters, can't you tell? Her eyelids grew wide and her chin rose as if defying him to notice a similarity. Maybe I could take Emmanuel's place. Bewildered, Zeke stared at her feet, not broad like her hands, but long and slender in dark purple hose. Was this humor too? He's not around, she said. She sounded so definite that for a moment Zeke wondered if she somehow knew Emmanuel. Then he remembered he was the one who had told her about him. The snooker and the bad back. Perhaps I could lend a hand. You, his chin prickled as if his beard were pushing against the skin. She gave a hoot. I'm not offering to spend 12 hours a day up a ladder, but some things are easier with two people, like folding sheets. I am, thought Duke, profoundly boring, a notion not contradicted by her announcement that she was going to check out the sleeping arrangement. Heels striking the floor, she carried her tea upstairs. Normally, he quit at 5, but today he kept pressing spackle into every, even the smallest crack. until close to 6:30 then, in the face of an unbroken silence from above, he admitted defeat. He tidied his tools in a way that his old boss, Ferdinand, had taught him. Two of them had been united in their meticulous attitude toward the object and their hesitation towards people. "You know, they say the brain has pathways," Ferdinand had said. "Mine are covered with sand." Zeke washed his hands and called the news of his departure wanly up the stairs. "Wait." There she was on the landing. "Are you coming tomorrow?" "When?" Her face was, once again, indistinguishable. "I aim for 8, he told her. "Shall I bring up your suitcases?" "No." The word hit him with such force that he grabbed the banister. He was still wondering what crime he'd committed when she added at more normal volume, "Thanks. I need the keys." She swam down the stairs, stopping on the last one, hands outstretched. He should have guessed then, from the way her eyes fastened on his, that something was awry, and that she wasn't on good terms with her aunt and uncle, or that Miss F. weren't all fetuses female at first, was a problematic guess. But the warmth of her breath, the tilt of her perfume, expunged rational thought. Helpless, he laid the keys in her palm. "Will you be up to let me in?" he said. "Up with the lark!" She made a flapping motion with one hand. "Up with the milkman!" "Are you all right?" he found himself asking. "There's always the razor and the knife," she said softly. Then, he pictured all the buses of London rising an inch into the air. She leaned forward and pressed her lips to his cheek. That's the end of part 2.